Hello. Good evening, everybody. I am Dr. Milind Patil, and I am an ex-professor and a pharmaceutical physician. Today we are going to speak on a very queer subject, a very relevant subject for modern days, and that is Ayurvedizing modern medicine. As Ayurvedic physicians, Ayurvedic doctors, we all know our first year days, first months in Ayurvedic college. Look at this. What do we learn in first year, first week, first month? Vikruta, vikruta, deham, granthi, te, vartayanti. What do we learn? We learn vayuh, pittam, kaphashchayati, trayo, doshaha, samasataha. What do we learn? We learn parvato, vanniman, dhumavatvat, etc., etc. What do we learn? I still remember that line. Iko yanachi. Ikaha sthane yanasya achi sanhitaya vishaye. And we don't really understand what is going on, because we fail to understand that how these Sanskrit lines are going to help us in diagnosis and treatment. And we keep wondering what is going to happen to our future career. But then we at Poddar College, Ari Poddar College in Mumbai, were fortunate enough in having a Guruji like Vaidya Vasudevji Vyas. For all of us, he was the benchmark teacher. For all of us, he was the most ideal Ayurvedic physician, because he knew his books well. Yasya Dvadasha Sahasri Hrudi Tishtati Samhita So Arthadnyaha Sa Vicharadnyaha Chikitsa Kushalasya Saha Rogan Tesham Chikitsam Cha Sakimartham Na Mudyate. This description appropriately described my teacher Vaidya Vasudev Vyas. He was Arthadneha, he knew his books well. He was Vicharadneha, he could do a critical thinking. He was a good clinician as well. He was a good Ayurvedic practitioner as well. And therefore, we got to understand that Ayurveda has a great future. Personally, to me, I was fortunate enough to be his colleague in Samhita department. He was our head of the department in Samhita department. I was a junior lecturer after being a student for 5.5 years in BAMS college. He used to tell me that, Milind, just have a faith, just have utmost Shraddha in the text, in Charak Shushruta Vaghbhata's text, because someday, sometime in future, modern medicine will understand the importance of what Ayurveda is, and Ayurveda will become the most relevant global Ayurveda medical science. And today, in Corona days, I feel that this is happening. Okay, I will just share my experience with this person, Nobel laureate Dr. Baruch Bloomberg. He got his Nobel Prize for the discovery of Australia antigen, hepatitis B surface antigen. And he was working on the effects of Phyllanthus neruri on hepatitis B. When he was presenting his topic of Phyllanthus neruri in hepatitis B, I was assisting him on the slide projector. Those were not the days of PowerPoint, etc., etc. I'm talking about 1986. So I was helping him on the slide projector. After he finishes his lecture, he comes to me to collect his slides, and he asks me, who are you, what are you, etc., etc. So I tell him that I am a research associate on this project of Phyllanthus neruri in hepatitis B. And with the curiosity, he asked me, what is the Ayurvedic recommendation? Why Bumyamalki or Phyllanthus neruri is where is recommended in Ayurveda? And I was fresh BAMS student waiting for my MD admission. And here the Nobel laureate, Dr. Baruch Bloomberg, is asking me a question. And I tell him, based on my current knowledge then, that we use Bumyamalki or Phyllanthus neruri in common cold. I remember that Kasahar Varga. We use Bumyamalki in Kamala, jaundice, hepatitis, and my teacher does prescribe Bumyamalki in certain skin diseases. And The first reaction of Dr. Baruj Bloomberg was, no wonder Bumya Malki has antiviral properties. That sentence I distinctly remember even today. No wonder that Bumya Malki has antiviral properties. And he did discover Bumya Malki's Phyllanthus niruris antiviral properties. He did establish that Bumya Malki inhibits endogenous DNA polymerase, that Bumya Malki inhibits binding of hepatitis B surface antigen to hepatitis B surface antibodies, and it has anti-inflammatory, antiviral activity as far as hepatitis B infection goes. Okay, so these memories of 86 are very clear in my mind, and this set a kind of activity which led me to believe in Ayurveda. And today I'm sharing some of the concepts, how Ayurveda is becoming modern science, how Tridosha system, how Tridosha theory, how Tridoshas are becoming modern in nature, that I will tell you. Just look at this picture, my friends. Look at that fly. Look at that plant's action. You get it from this picture that life is struggle for survival. And during the struggle from birth to death, we have to adapt our responses so that we survive long. Just look at this again. We call Ayurveda as Ayushovedaha, science of life. Life is struggle for survival. And when I say that Ayurveda is for swastasya swastharakshanam, aturasya vikara prashamanam, I mean that Ayurveda recommends dinacharya, rutacharya, langan chikitsa, bruhan chikitsa, rasayan and vajikaran to make our struggle successful so that we survive long, so that we have a dirghayu, disease-free dirghayu longevity. Okay, so I will continue with this. Life is anadi, ananta and shashwat, and therefore Ayurveda is anadi, ananta and shashwat. That is what my teacher kept us telling. Okay, so with this slide, we will go ahead. And now we know for sure, be it corona days or be it HIV days, okay, all eyes are on Ayurveda. Just appreciate the basic principles of Ayurveda. We have Panchabhautik Ahar consisting of Prithvi, Jal, Tej, Vayu and Akash. Before the raw materials of the foods enter the body, they are processed in the kitchen and we get the finished product, the food in our thali, in our dish. This is further processed within the body and it is converted into two parts, Sar and Kitta. Sar is utilized for development of functional elements of the body. Those are Vata, Pitta, Kapha. And structural elements of the body, we call them Dhatus, Rasa, Rakta, Mans, Med, Asti, Majja and Shukra. And then in the process of processing, certain excretory products are created which are thrown out of the body. So as we learn in our first year BMS, body is composite of Dosha, Dhatu, Mala, functional elements, structural elements and excretory products. With this background, we go ahead. Just see the title, Adaptive Cellular Stress Pathways as Therapeutic Targets of Dietary Phytochemicals Focus on the Nervous System. When I read this article published in 2014, I feel that Vata Kala Kali Adhyay becomes very meaningful here. Okay, what does it say? That certain dietary phytochemicals do have a role to play in therapy and prevention of disorders by affecting adaptive cellular stress pathways. So when there is Hetu 7, we get the disease and our adaptive cellular stress responses become active, and if they overcome the disease process, we will stay healthy. Otherwise, we will become diseased. Just look at this figure. The middle portion of this figure is Latin and Greek to me. But then what do I understand? That phytochemicals and adaptive responses, just look at here, phytochemicals, and they do mention amla there, and nutrient deprivation, langan. So these are the inputs. Then this is cytoplasm, and just see the targets of this langan, upvas, amla, etc. And these are various intracellular targets. If they are inhibited, this is inhibition, this is activation, this is inhibition, this is. If they are inhibited, we have muscle growth, we have cholesterol reduction, cancer risk is decreased, insulin secretion increases, inflammation decreases, Alzheimer's disease decreases, adipogenesis decreases, mitochondrial biogenesis improves, and glucose response improves. Okay, this is all because of activation of certain protein, anti-aging protein, which is called as SERPINE1. It modifies multiple downstream target proteins. These are the multiple downstream target proteins. As I said earlier, this may appear Latin and Greek to us, but then so be it. But then when our therapies like langan and upvas and phytochemicals affect these targets, the end result is less. And because of modification of multiple downstream target proteins involved in adaptive cellular stress response. So be it Dinacharya, be it Rutucharya, be it langan medicine, be it bhuvan medicine, be it herbal, mineral or herbo-mineral medicine, it will have certain effect intracellularly so that we get these benefits. And these are all complete health benefits. We will look at the Nobel Prizes, because I had that interaction with Dr. Baruch Bloomberg. I thought that let us understand the Nobel Prizes in 2015, 16, 17, 2018 and 2019. In 2015, I still remember my first year BMS, my close relative did say, now aap jadi buti doge. Now we will go into the jadi buti medicine. And then I was hurt, but then I recall that comment. Okay. And when in 2015, some scientist got a Nobel Prize for herb having anti-malarial action, then I remember that this is what is the ancient science, Ayurvedic science, Prachin medicine, being acknowledged at the Nobel Prize level, and certain plant and certain scientists got the Nobel Prize for identifying anti-malarial activity of that jadi buti. This was the beginning of a series of Nobel Prizes which proved the authenticity of Ayurvedic principles. In 2016, Dr. Yoshinori Oshumi got the Nobel Prize for his discoveries of mechanisms for autophagy. What is autophagy? Autophagy is the mechanism, mode of mechanism of our langan, of our upvas. Okay, what is the samyak yoga of langan? Samyak yoga of langan is as per charak, vata mutra purishanam visarge gatra lagave rudaya udgara kantasya shuddhau tandraklame gate svede jate ruchai chaiva shut pipasa sahode krutam langanam adesham nirvathe chantaratmane. All these benefits of langan are because of certain intracellular process which is called as autophagy. And this mechanism was identified by Dr. Yoshinori Oshumi in certain e-studies, and he called that mechanism as autophagy. Autophagy is mode of mechanism of major Ayurvedic therapy which is called as Langan. I would request all of you to appreciate a shloka from Harit Samhita. The shloka reads, Parishrama Mitaharo, Bhugatau Ashwini Sutau, Tav Anadrutya Naivaham, Vaidyamanyam Shamachre. A certain diseased person, a patient, is talking to his friend and he is asking that healthy friend, Are how come you are so healthy? Which physician do you go to? Why don't you tell me? Why don't you guide? Because I am very sick person. I always fall sick. I am always a diseased person. And then this friend who is healthy responds. He says, Parishrama Mitaharau, Bhugatau Ashwini Sutau, Tav Anadrutya Naivaham, Vaidyamanyam Shamashre. What does he say? That my friend, here on earth, we have Ashwini Kumars available to us. Those are Parishram and Mitahar. I never disrespect them. And because I don't disrespect them, I follow Parishram and Mitahar. I don't have to go to any other Vaidya. So better to stay healthy, to stay fit, you have to go to these two physicians. Parishram is surgeon and Mitahar is physician. And how do these two, Parishram and Mitahar, work? What is their exact mode of mechanism in the body so that we stay healthy, so that we remain disease-free for a long time? That mechanism is identified, discovered by Dr. Yoshinori Oshumi. He called it as autophagy, and he got the 2016 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for that discovery. So just think of that shloka from Harita Samhita, Parishrama Mitaharo Bhugato Vashvini Suto. Till this moment, we had but one option to believe the shloka. We have a faith. Yes, Harit Samhita mentioned this, and it compares Parishrama and Mitahar to Sakshat Ashwini Kumars, which are the twin deities and physician surgeons to the gods. We believe it. We believe the text. We understand the importance. And then we put it in practice and stay healthy. But now we know that both Parishram and Mitahar work through autophagy. And autophagy will cleanse the intracellular debris. And that debris cleansed, that debris cleared, will make us healthy. So this was 2016 Nobel Prize. After he received the Nobel Prize, naturally, papers wrote what the Nobel Prize for Medicine means for Ayurvedic research. It means that we have veritable treasure of sound medical observations waiting to get biology unraveled. This unraveling would enhance both Ayurveda and biology. This is how the newspaper said. And then something appeared in blog December 6, 2017, which reads as follows, Fasting and Autophagy, Ancient Wisdom, Wisdom in Charakshushrut Vagbhat, and Scientific Research Intersect. So gradually, my point is, modern medicine is becoming Ayurveda. And I will explain this in quite a simple steps here. So many traditional rituals are disappearing from modern civilization, but fortunately, something is still preserved among the innocent peoples in India. They may not understand the significance of these rituals, but they have maintained their observance. And this observance is very, very important, because gradually we are starting to understand the modern modes of mechanisms of these rituals. Look at that line. Yatecha yatha kalam malanam shodhanam prati. That malanam shodhan may be because of Parishram and Mitahar. That malanam shodhan may be because of certain amopachic medicine. That malanam shodham can be panchakarma, vaman, virechan, basti, etc., etc. So autophagy or self-eating was the step in the most right direction for realizing, for modern scientists to understand that traditional, say, ancient systems do have certain purpose. And let us go ahead. Just look at these two books. This is the Bible of Pharmacology. Goodman Gilman, The Pharmacological Basis of Therapeutics, 12th edition. And look at the cover of Goodman Gilman, Pharmacological Basis of Therapeutics, 13th edition. In third chapter of 12th edition, Pharmacodynamics, Molecular Mechanisms of Drug Action, only one word occurs there, autophagy, and nothing but the words mentioned. Only one word, autophagy, is mentioned. But in 13th edition of Goodman Gilman, this is the 13th edition of Goodman Gilman, we got a paragraph on autophagy in the chapter titled Pharmacodynamics, Molecular Mechanisms of Drug Action. You may read this as Molecular Mechanisms of Langan Chikitsa in Ayurveda. What does it read? Autophagy is a highly regulated, multi-step, catabolic pathway in which cellular contents, including aggregate-prone proteins, organelles such as mitochondria and peroxisomes, and infectious agents are sequestered within double membrane vesicles known as autophagosomes, then delivered to lysosomes where fusion occurs and autophagosome contents are degraded by lysosomal proteases. So, in simple terms, the debris, the mala accumulated in the cell is destroyed by a mechanism which is called autophagy. And just appreciate the description of autophagy is highly regulated, multi-step, catabolic pathway. These words do describe very appropriately the Langan Karma, the Langan Therapy, the Langan Chikitsa of Ayurveda. So, books are changing, my friends. The modern medicine book, Pharmacological Basis of Therapeutics, is changing. This is the 13th edition. And what is that change? It is incorporating Ayurvedic principles. And maybe 14th edition or 15th edition or 16th edition, you will find the chapter devoted to autophagy and talking about the modes of mechanisms of various herbs, various herbomineral medicine, and various behavioral routines to explain on the terms of autophagy. So autophagy is absolutely an Ayurvedic concept. So when I say that modern medicine is becoming Ayurveda, I mean this, that gradually the books are including the concepts like Langan, and they are talking about molecular mechanisms of drug action. Then in 2017, these three scientists got their Nobel Prize for their discoveries of molecular mechanisms controlling the circadian rhythm. In our first year, what do we read? Brahme Muhurte Uttishtet Swasto Raksharatham Ayusha. You should get up early in the morning. This is the Upadesh for Swastha Vyakti for preserving the health. Swastaha Purushaha Ayushaha Raksharatham Brahme Muhurte Uttishtet. That is how we can do the anvaya of this shloka. Brahme Muhurte Uttishtet Swasto Raksharatham Ayushaha. Swastaha Ayushaha Raksharatham Brahme Muhurte Uttishtet. Why? Because there are certain molecular mechanisms controlling the circadian rhythm, and if we keep those circadian rhythms proper, normal, then we stay healthy, we remain disease free. Because day and night is life. So night is meant for peace, protection, parasympathetic system is active. Day is meant for survival, stress, sympathetic nervous system is active. And to keep this parasympathetic system and sympathetic nervous system in balance, to keep so sympathetic overactivity under control, we must get up at the Brahma Muhurta, so that the, and these molecular mechanisms are identified by these three doctors, three scientists, and they got their Nobel Prize. So that was 2015 for herb, 2016 for Langan, 2017 for Brahme Muhurte Uttishtet. And then 2018, we can beat cancer by modulating immunity. 2018, and Nobel Prize went to these doctors. We know for sure the importance of immunity, because my teacher used to always say that dosha samya, the stronger the dosha samya, the stronger the immunity. And therefore, when somebody asks you, where does Ayurveda describe the concept of immunity? So just say that the stronger the dosha samya, stronger the immunity. And therefore, if we can want to beat cancer, that immune mechanisms need to be, that dosha samya has to be maintained lifelong, and then you can prevent cancer. That was 2018. Now just see, 2019 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for their discoveries of how cells sense and adapt to oxygen availability. The awarded mechanism for oxygen sensing has fundamental importance in physiology. For example, for our metabolism, immune responses, and ability to adapt to exercise. They did identify a molecule, hypoxia sensing molecule. And I will give you a homework. When you read the Pandurog Chikitsa, and when we look at those herbs which do not really contain iron, they are also recommended for the Chikitsa of Pandurog. So probably the herbs in Punarnava Mandu, probably the herbs in Navaya Sloha are responsible for affecting this mechanism of oxygen sensing. Okay, and one must travel on that path. When I want to understand the modes of mechanisms of anti-Pandurog medicines described in Ayurveda, I will refer to the work of these three scientists, which talk about their discoveries of how cells sense and adapt to oxygen availability. Something somewhere in this pathway, our medicines do have their role to play. Maybe it is Vidanga, maybe it is Chitra. Then let us continue our studies in this direction. So friends, we have seen the Nobel Prizes from 2015 to 2019. I just keep thinking that what will be the 2020 Nobel Prize for. Okay, and then I'm pretty sure that future Nobel Prizes will establish the authenticity, or will give some modes of mechanisms or explanation for our hardcore Ayurvedic science, the most authentic science which is contained in Bruhatrayi, Laghutrayi and all ancient Ayurvedic textbooks. No wonder that Ayurvedic plants have been identified to have the effect on these many diseases. Obesity, epilepsy, fatigue, multiple sclerosis, Crohn's disease, metabolic disease, neoplastic, and you look at those psoriasis, HIV, inflammatory, wound healing, hepatitis, etc., etc. And I need not really tell you the role of Ayurvedic plants as anti-aging medicines. Okay, asthma, arthritis, diabetes, etc., etc. And all these mechanisms are studied, and they are becoming aware of the modern modes of actions of Ayurvedic plants in various multiple disorders. So when I say that modern medicine is becoming Ayurved, I mean that they are proving Anadi, Ananta, Shashwatatva of Ayurveda. And that is why this is a big opportunity for all of us. Look at this H. pylori, red meat, high fat, grilled food, radiation, tobacco, alcohol, stress, and number of viruses. They do affect certain biological, chemical, nuclear factor kappa. And this affected will lead to inflammation, proliferation, invasion, angiogenesis, metastasis. Let these alphabetics remain Greek and Latin to us. But then All this activity will lead to chronic disorders, diabetes, colitis, inflammatory bowel disease, obesity, etc., etc., asthma and cancer. So what does Ayurveda do? We have to inhibit nuclear factor Kappa B so that we treat these chronic diseases. Just look at this. Sarva roga prashamani arogya vardhini. Bahuna atra ki mukte na sarva rogeshu shasyate. By its mechanism on nuclear factor Kappa. And what does happen? We can identify novel biological actions of Ayurvedic medicines. What do we identify as a novel mechanisms of action? We get antioxidant activity, anti-inflammatory activity, anti-thrombotic activity, pro-fibrinolytic activity, anti-atherosclerotic activity. And I remember that line, Deepani Pachani Pathya Sroto Marga Vishodini. Just understand this, antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, anti-thrombotic, pro-fibrinolytic, anti-atherosclerotic, and recall that one single line from Arogyavardhini's Phalashruti, the line which reads Deepani Pachani Pathya, Deepani Pachani Pathya Sroto Marga Vishodhini, and therefore it is called as Arogyavardhini, Sarva Roga Prashamani, Bahunatra Ki Muktena Sarva Rogeshu Shasyate. This is how Ayurvedic medicines are going to be understood in modern medicine, and that's a great good sign. I'll take you ahead. Role of herbal medicines in areas where modern medicines fail. Corona, we are looking at corona, and day in, day out, morning hours, we have a positive news of some drug in modern medicine, and the very day, the evening, we are told that that medicine may not be that much effective. Okay, antibiotic resistance is the burning problem. Okay, and unfortunately, India is the worst country suffering from antimicrobial resistance. And India is the best country suited for treatment of antimicrobial resistance. How, we will see. So, Ayurveda does not recommend healing. Sarvatra Maitri. Can we find new ways to manage infection? The germs are developing ways to disable host immune and mutating to develop antibiotic resistance. And this is very much the big problem all over the world, especially in India. And therefore, Ayurveda does come to rescue because we don't believe in killing. That Vagbhata's line, Sarvatra Maitri, Sarvatra Maitri, even Maitri with the microbes. Okay, we don't allow them to damage us, but then we won't kill them. That's the philosophy of Ayurveda. And where do we focus? In Ayurveda, we do focus on reducing the virulence of the organism. We don't worry about the number of microorganisms. So when it comes to treatment of infectious disorders, Ayurvedic therapies will reduce the virulence of the microorganism, and it will also improve the host resistance. And that's how Dr. Sharadini Dahanukar did call Ayurvedic therapy as pro-host therapy. Okay, so the chikitsa of infectious disorders in Ayurveda believes in reducing the virulence power of microorganism and increase the host resistance so that likelihood of infection is reduced. And this is also being appreciated in modern sciences. See, this is a standard infection. There are certain quorum sensing molecules, and they make sure that microorganism gets attached to the mucous membranes, tissues, so that they start attacking. So we need to address quorum sensing molecules, which make microorganism gather. Okay, Ayurvedic medicines prevent bacterial adhesion to the membrane. Okay, so they can't really stick to the body tissues. And when I say they can't really stick to get attached to the body tissues, I mean that something like Ayurvedic medicines do something to the Pichila Guna, amaghna, amadosha, nashak, and because of amaghna dosha, amadosha nashak guna, they don't allow microbes to adhere to, stick to the body tissues. And then Ayurvedic medicines like Guruji also, they break the communication between two bacteria. They break the communication, that is called as quorum quenching, interference with bacterial communication. When bacteria finds a attachable place in the tissues, it calls other bacteria by activating these molecules, which are called as quorum quenching. So we, by prescribing Guruji, quorum quenching is done. Bacteria fail to communicate with each other. They don't come into groups, and single bacteria is easily handled by the defense mechanisms of the body. And then virulence factor inhibition is also there. Okay, as I said. So this is how all Jorajna Chikitsa will work. Where does the Jorajna Chikitsa work? It will not allow quorum fencing molecules to be active. It will not allow microbes to get attached to the tissues. It will reduce the virulence of the bacterium, and therefore it will overcome the bacterial infection. And look at that ingredient, curcumin, haridra, ayush kadha, that we take every day in the morning. Curcumin, an antibiotic resistant breaker against multi-resistant clinical isolates, 2017. Curcumin either alone or combined with antibiotics could provide a novel strategy to combat antibiotic resistance and virulence of Mycobacterium abscessus. Okay, so even so-called strength of modern medicine of antibiotics is not a strength at all. Okay, it has become a liability, because microbes have developed resistance to this, and this is where Ayurveda will play its role in breaking the antibiotic resistance. And that curcuma has a strategic synergistic activity with antibiotics. Synergy between curcumin and antibiotics. Studies have shown synergistic activity of curcumin with beta-lactam and quinolone antibiotics. So here also, the very same strength of antibiotics of modern medicine is not the strength but the liability, and there also our medicine do help. Curcumin reverses methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. So even also dealing with our coronaviruses, we need to understand that curcuma does play an important role, not by killing the virus, but making it sure that virus fails to attack our systems. Okay. It can be called as Pranavasrutas Rasayan, if at all you want to call it by that name. Ayurveda has important role to play in, I'll just cite one example, in female disease. Just try to understand, friends, where we wrote our books in aphorisms, in sutras, in little Sanskrit words and shlokas. And when somebody said that the paryaya or synonym of haridra is yoshitapriya, the word yoshitapriya means beloved of a woman. What does it really mean? It comes from the Ayurvedic text. What is the medical therapeutic relevance of the word yoshitapriya? Yoshitapriya means it is good for face. Yoshitapriya means it is good for figure, anti-obesity. Yoshitapriya means it is good for fertility. And then we understand, why do we call haldi as yoshitapriya? Because it is cosmetic, it has anti-obesity effects, and it does promote fertility by inducing ovulation. Just see, PCOS is the major cause of female infertility. PCOS has underlying insulin resistance. And the best medicine for diabetes is haridra प्रमेयहाराणाम मेषु धात्री निशे, एंड देन यू कैन थिंक ऑफ धात्री निशा कॉम्बिनेशन और योषित प्रिया हरिद्रा इन द थेरेपी ऑफ पॉलीसिस्टिक ओवेरियन डिजीज. जस्ट लुक एट दिस कुरकुमा सप्लीमेंटेशन गिवन इन पॉलीसिस्टिक ओवरी सिंड्रोम कॉम्प्लिकेशंस. It does reduce insulin resistance. It does reduce androgen levels. It does reduce blood glucose levels. Okay, and this is recently published report to be published in 2021 Phytomedicines. What does it say? Effects of curcumin supplementation on blood glucose, insulin resistance, and androgens in patients with PCOAs, a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled clinical trial. What does the conclusion read? Curcumin might be a safe and useful supplement to ameliorate PCOS-associated hyperandrogenemia and hyperglycemia. However, longer trials investigating different dosages in longer durations are needed to underpin this second line. However, etc., etc., is common line in modern literature. They don't understand that we have been using Dhatri for very same indications for a millennia, okay? But then they will understand it very gradually. Just see this. When was this line written? Charaka days, Vagbhata days. This day, 2021, what does it say? Curcumin reduces blood glucose, curcumin improves insulin sensitivity, curcumin decreases androgens. What does it say? Curcumin is Yoshita Priya. It does give you cosmetic benefits, anti-obesity, it keeps your blood glucose low, and it does improve your fertility. Okay, and therefore, a simple one word, Yoshita Priya, has such a modern significance, and therefore Ayurveda is becoming modern medicine. Just see, these are various anti-diabetic modern molecules. I don't go into the details because I don't know the details myself, but I know for sure at the very same locations, targets, our Ayurvedic Pramegna medicines do work. Haldi, Guduchi, Haldi, Amalaki, Haldi, Karela, etc., etc. And this itself is becoming modernized science. Just look at this. COVID days. We take that Ayush Kadha early in the morning containing Haldi. Don't call Haldi as a home remedy. It is something like Amrut, and they have identified molecular mechanisms of curcumin in COVID-19 for treatment as well for prevention, a global health perspective. So when I say that modern medicine is becoming Ayurveda, a decade, two decades in future, and you will see complete Harrison and complete Goodman Gilman talking high about Ayurvedic principles. Just see, the process has already begun of integrating various therapies. Look at the title, Integrative Health Promotion. Integrative Pediatrics. Integrative Women's Health. Integrative Cardiology. Look at that exercising person. Integrative Oncology. Again Yogasana. Again Phytomedicine. Complementary and Integrative Medicine in Cancer Care and Prevention. Complementary and Alternative Medicine for Older Adults. Rasayan. Complementary and Alternatives Cancer Therapies. Mayo Clinic. Book of Alternative Medicine. Clinical Botanical Medicine. Botanical Medicine. bench to bedside. Botanical medicine for women's health. The biological activity of phytochemicals. Natural standard herbal pharmacotherapy. Evidence-based approach. My friends, you looked at the titles of these books. They all do talk about integrating traditional medicines, integrating herbal medicines with modern medicine. But I think this era is also going to be over, and we will transform modern medicine into Ayurveda very soon. The need of the hour is to continue our medical education. Satata adhyanam vadaha paratantravalokanam tadvidya acharya sevacha buddhi medha karoganaha. Every remedy, every upay is described in our Charakshushrut Vagbhat and Laghutri. We don't have to support Ayurveda. No, we have to respect Ayurveda. And we do have to show utmost respect to Ayurveda. By showing utmost respect, what do? We read, we understand, and we practice Ayurveda. So, Satat Adhyayan, attending conferences, looking at what other sciences are doing, and then Tadvidya Acharya Sevacha, being with the experts of those topics, is going to increase our knowledge, and we should do what Sushruta is asking us to do. Because Charak does say, Krishno hi loko buddhimatam acharya. I quote this letter very often, written by Samiran Nandi in BMJ in 2004. There is no end to the learning of Ayurveda. Hence, you should carefully and constantly devote yourself to it. You should increase your skill by learning from others without jealousy. The wise regard the whole world as their teacher, Krishno hi loko buddhimatam acharya, whereas the ignorant consider it to be their enemy. From Charak Samhita, one of the most important fundamental works on Ayurveda, it is based on the teaching of the sage Atreya, initially written by Agnivisha, etc., etc. So, we have to take this tradition ahead to modern times, so that in this struggle for survival, we make use of Dinacharya, Rutucharya, Rasayan medicines, herbal medicine, so that we handle those adaptive cellular responses properly and stay healthy, disease-free, with long life. My last slide, my friends. First chapter of Ayurvedic books, Ashtanga Hrudaya or Ashtanga Sangraha. First year of Ayurvedic course, what do we read? Vayu Pittam Kaphasheti Trayodoshaha Samasata. What do we read? Vikruta Avikruta Deham Granthite Vartayanti Cha. And what do I read in the title of these books? Damage associated molecular patterns in human diseases. Second volume does read, title, Damage associated molecular patterns in human diseases. Volume 1 is injury induced innate immune responses. I have gone through the prefaces of these books and the description of these books. The first volume is published in 2018 perhaps, and the second volume is recently published. It does refer to Corona pandemic 19. COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. When I read these terms, damage associated molecular patterns, I thought of tridoshas. I thought of so-called humor therapy, which is the humorous description of tridoshas. But then complete chapters of this book do talk about vata, pitta and kapha. Do talk about the functional micro elements of the body, and they name it as damage associated molecular patterns. So Hetu Sevan will cause the damage and Dosha Vaishamya will occur. Medicine Sevan, Aushadha Sevan will address that Dosha Vaishamya and bring back that homeostasis to its equilibrium. This is the description of these two books published in 2019 and 2018. And I have gone through the prefaces and few chapters of these books, and they do talk about the concept of Vata, Pitta and Kapha. And therefore, my friends, when my line says that Charaka's or Shushruta's line says, Dosha evai sarvesham roganam eka karanam, Dosha Samya is Chikitsa. That has been explained in modern terms in these two books. And gradually, these two books contains will become part of the textbooks of medicine, textbooks of modern medicine. And this is how Ayurveda is becoming modern medicine. So when I say modern medicine is Ayurvedizing, I mean that modern medical sciences is nothing like allopathy. We call it as modern medicine. When I say modern medicine is Ayurvedizing, I mean that all our ancient Ayurvedic concepts are becoming part of modern medical textbooks. And we must take this opportunity to understand in depth, in width, the application of Ayurvedic principles in prevention of diseases and in therapy of certain diseases and in staying healthy with longevity. But then we have to do this. We can't really sit at the bottom of the well, because he who sits at the bottom of the well to contemplate the sky, what is that sky? That sky is Ayurveda. Anadi, Ananta, Aparampar. Okay, we can't really sit there and think of Anadi, Shashwat, Aparampar, Ayurveda. We have to come out of it. So he who sits at the bottom of the well to contemplate the sky will find it very small. Therefore, we have to come out of that well. Kupa Mandukruti will not help us. Just try to understand that doctor who has the Nobel Prize for discovering that hepatitis virus was asking a very junior doctor, Milind Patil, where do you describe what are the properties of Bhumya Malki or Phyllanthus neruri in Ayurvedic text? And when I share that piece of information with him, that we use it in respiratory tract infections, we use it in certain skin disorders, and we use Bhumya Malki in Kamala, his one exclamatory statement, no wonder that is an antiviral activity. Okay, he was that open-minded person. He was so open to discuss with the most junior, some Ayurvedic doctor. So we need to come out of this well. Then only we will realize the importance, the greatness of Ayurveda, which my teacher, Vaidya Vasudeji Vyas, wanted me to realize by flying in the sky, which is Vibhu, Nitya, Anadi, Ananta, just like Ayurveda. Thank you, friends, for paying attention to my lecture. I will again conclude by saying that the trends in modern sciences are going towards establishing the scientific principles or establishing the truthfulness of Ayurvedic concepts. Our need, our duty at the moment is to read, understand, and put into practice whatever Ayurveda has advised us to do, so that we make the world disease-free. We make the world healthy. And that should be the utmost duty. That's how we respect. We show our utmost respect to Ayurveda. We read it. We understand it. And we put those therapies in practice and stay healthy. Thank you. Thank you for kind attention.